Hey guys, I'm Mike.
And my name is Joe.
And you're listening to How Many Fingers Am I Holding Up, the podcast, featuring two guys getting sworn into office and reviewing movies in a weekly podcast form.
And thank you to Dan Martin for that synonym. Always coming through.
With Dan Martin, always coming through.
Come through.
But we're not reviewing a movie this week. If you haven't watched our Establishing Shot episodes from last year, we're going to start those again this year. And we're going to do a review of the 2017 Oscar nominations for the first Establishing Shot of 2017.
Right on.
If you can't tell, it's not our usual recording day. We're recording the day after recording a bunch of episodes. Hence the disheveled hair and the coffee in front of us. Because we're drinking Kentucky coffee with backbone bourbon and whipped cream. Which, it's going to be interesting. I already took a sip of it and immediately ran to the bathroom.
Yeah.
Excited to do a whole episode of this.
There's a whole assortment of things that Mike brought. I mean, it's coffee.
Brown sugar for the sugar portion. And then heavy cream. Mm-hmm. And then backbone bourbon, which I think is part of the problem because it's a very strong bourbon. It's like 104 proof, maybe.
Right.
And they recommend like 80 to 90 proof.
Mm-hmm.
This is what I had.
Oh,
put some whipped cream on this.
Put my spoon down. I keep clanking it right under the mic for future Mike to edit. How's that whipped cream, boy?
Looks beautiful.
I'm not a huge whipped cream person.
That's actually nice. It sweetens it up a bit. I can dig it.
Yeah, that is pretty good. But yeah, this is... I feel like there's so many lulls in this. Just
yeah, I mean, it's a more informal type of episode. We don't have notes really written out for this. We're really going to go through it for the first time and actively discuss each category.
We did do three... kind of wild episodes last... I mean, not wild, but, I mean, Kevin was on one.
Oh, last night.
Yeah. Last night, yeah. So I still have a pretty pounding headache. This is not helping. You think it would?
The coffee's not helping.
The coffee and really strong bourbon. You think there'd be some sort of hair of a dog and caffeine saving... No, it's kind of getting worse. I kind of have to, squint because I have a headache.
Sugar probably doesn't help either.
Oh, yeah, no, it's true.
Actually, I don't know if that's a scientific fact.
We woke up, got our pizza, and started our day.
All right. Let's get some real quick announcements out of the way real quick.
Yeah,
the Handy Awards are still going on. Let's just breeze through those nominees real quick.
All right, yeah.
Give you guys an idea of who's been nominated. If you haven't
Real awards before we get into the Oscars.
Yes. Yeah. Show you some real nominations. If you haven't heard or watched any of the videos about the Handy Awards or seen any of the million posts that we've been making on our social media about it, Handy Awards is basically our version of the Oscars where we get to nominate what we think is deserving. And then you guys get to vote on those nominees and see which will actually win. A handy. Who do we give a handy to?
Who are we going to give handies to this year? We decided the nominations, but it's you guys who decide. I'm really just reiterating what Mike just said. But if you haven't seen the nominee, the official 2017 nominee announcement video, I highly recommend it. And that's the thing.
It's nice.
If you're only following us on SoundCloud or whatever you listen to podcasts through, you're missing a whole chunk of How Many Fingers.
Go find our other social media. We got Facebook, How Many Fingers Podcast, Twitter at HMF Podcast, Instagram, How Many Fingers Podcast, and howmanyfingerspodcast.tumblr.com. And then for all these awards for the handies, if you hear any of these nominees that you feel strongly about and you want to participate in voting, just go to any of those social media platforms and leave a comment on the appropriate post or just send us a message. Get in contact with us in any way using the hashtag GiveAHandyTo followed by who you want to give a handy to in the category. And we'll count your vote and we'll count all that up. And voting will end on February 12th. We'll have a prestigious and elegant ceremony on February 24th on our YouTube. So you can look forward to that. Let's just breeze through these nominations real quick for those who haven't heard.
Let's do it. And these are the 2017 Handy nominations.
Yes.
Not the Oscars.
Best Picture, we've got Arrival, Everybody Wants Some, Green Room, Hell or High Water, Jackie, Manchester by the Sea, Moonlight, Silence, Swiss Army Man, and The Witch.
And for Best Director, we nominated Barry Jenkins in Moonlight, Dan Kwan and Daniel Scheinert in Swiss Army Man, Jeremy Saulnier in Green Room, Pablo Larraín.
Larraín.
You guys are going to hear a lot of that this Thursday. Because this comes out tomorrow, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So this Thursday, you're going to hear a lot of, oh, Larraín. And Robert Eggers for The Witch.
For Best Actress, we've got Amy Adams for Arrival, Anya Taylor-Joy for The Witch, Emily Blunt for The Girl on the Train, Natalie Portman for Jackie, and Ruth Negga for Loving.
I tried tweeting Anya Taylor-Joy.
She has a Twitter.
Yeah, so I tweeted her and I said, hey, congratulations, and she hasn't got back to me yet.
That bitch!
what
best
did
actor.
You?
You're a best actor.
Okay, for best actor, we have Anton Yelchin, the late Anton Yelchin.
Rest in peace.
For Green Room, Casey Affleck for Manchester by the Sea, Denzel Washington for Fences, Joel Edgerton for Loving, and Paul Dano for Swiss Army Man.
For best supporting actress, we have Imogen Poots for Green Room, Michelle Williams for Manchester by the Sea, Naomi Harris for Moonlight, Scarlett Johansson for Hail Caesar, and Viola Davis for Fences.
And Best Supporting Actor, we have Adam Driver, Silence, Alden Allwright, Hail Caesar, Daniel Radcliffe, Swiss Army Man, Jeff Bridges in Hell or High Water, and Mahershala Ali in Moonlight.
And we've got a few podcast categories as well. We've got Best Guest. We talked about this. You'll hear about this next week. But anyone who's been a guest on the podcast,
right.
Coincidentally, it worked out that everyone who was a guest in 2015 came back in 2016.
Mm-hmm.
So any of those guests are eligible for a 2016 or 2017, rather, Handy Award for Best Guest. For Best Episode, any episode from 2016. So that would be episode 17, 13 hours up until this episode, basically. And Best Host, you can vote between Joe or myself.
Yes.
You're going to help end our friendship by deciding who is the better host of this podcast that we both work very hard on. And as we said, you can vote for any of those categories using hashtag GiveAHandyTo on any of our social media, email, however you can get in contact with us. We'll get it counted. Voting closes February 12th, ceremony on February 24th. And Joe, why don't you tell them about that sticker contest we got going on?
I will tell them about that sticker test that we got.
Sticker test.
is this a sticker? That was a test. Again, in this upcoming episode, our review of Jackie, we read a pretty funny review that somebody left on iTunes. Again, you'll have to listen to the next episode to hear it, but it is quite the review. It's quite the review of us.
Yes.
Of our review. I think they were particularly peeved about our Hacksaw Ridge review, and they had some choice words. It was all pretty PG, though.
It was a great review.
Nobody said anything. Nobody had to cuss or anything. Not that I mind that. Do whatever you want. But again, we realized we have like 6 reviews on iTunes, and that really... iTunes reviews really bolsters people's podcast. Did I use that word right? Bolster?
Right? I don't know.
Like if you were to bolster something, you would...
I think.
A long, thick pillow that is placed under other pillows for support.
A bolster, yeah.
Support or strengthen? Prop up. Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. I've never heard of a bolster pillow. Like I was saying, we need some iTunes reviews. Even if you don't listen on iTunes, open up iTunes, leave us a review. Of course, we'd prefer a 5-star, but I don't want to feel like
we're not trying to buy your review. Leave us a review of any kind, and you'll be eligible for a free sticker. So if you're comfortable giving out your address, you can email us at howmanyfingerspodcast@gmail.com, and we'll ship you a sticker free of charge, free postage, completely free. And then we're going to run that contest until Friday, February 17th, I believe it is. And then at the end, we're going to decide which review we thought was best, what made us laugh the most, made us cry the most, touched us the most, just our favorite review. And that one's going to win a free koozie from us as well. Free of charge, free shipping, completely free.
So it's really easy. It's
have no excuse not to participate.
Yeah. These
takes 2 seconds.
These next 3 weeks, literally leave a review for us on iTunes. Gmail us about it. Not email us. Gmail us about
specifically,
it.
Specifically, if it's not from a Gmail account, we will not count it.
Leave a review. Email us about it. We'll send you stickers. It's that easy. Who else is doing something like this?
Bada bing, bada boom.
Who else is giving out $10 t-shirts?
But yeah, I think let's get into these nominations. Where to begin with this? I think we can talk about maybe
category by category.
Well, I just want to go down like who were kind of the front runners for this, like, or do you want to save that for the end?
Oh, I don't care.
Because we've got La La Land,
right,
was the clear front runner for all of this.
Mm-hmm.
It was nominated in 14 categories, which ties the record for Titanic, and I'm blanking on the other movie. It's from like the 50s, I think, an older classic movie.
Okay.
14 nominations.
Take your word
as well.
For it. Yeah. Sounds about right.
And then in second place, you had Arrival and Moonlight with 8 apiece, followed by Manchester by the Sea and Hacksaw Ridge and Lion at 6 apiece. Fences and Hell or High Water at 4 apiece. Jackie, Hidden Figures at 3 apiece. And then at 2 apiece, you've got Florence Foster Jenkins, Rogue One, Star Wars Story, Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them, Mona, A Man Called Ove, Kubo and the Two Strings, and Deepwater Horizon. Oh, and Passengers, because that did well.
Yes. Critically acclaimed Passengers.
How could we forget?
Boy. But let's talk about these. Let's break it down.
Category by category.
Should did you have anything else to say before?
No, I can bring that up at the end. Because I had done my own predictions for how the nominations weren't going to turn out, which I've never done before. I've always done predicting who's going to win, but
right,
I never predicted who's going to be nominated. It's from a much bigger field, obviously.
Right. Yeah.
Let's talk about that at the end, though. So,
okay.
Are you on the Wikipedia page?
I'm just on the Oscar.com/nominees. So, I mean, I just have everything right in front of me. I mean,
I don't know if they're in the same order, though.
Oh, true. I mean, do we want to... I mean, do you...
Oscar.com, I'll just go there.
Do we just want to... Yeah, Oscar.go.com/nominees. Do we just want to read them out loud and then...
And then we'll have, you know, we'll see how we feel about if anything surprised us.
All right, so do you want to read us the best pictures?
Let's start from the bottom.
Oh. Start from the bottom, now we're here.
So we've got writing original screenplay. In this category, we've got Hell or High Water, La La Land, The Lobster, Manchester by the Sea, and 20th Century Woman.
I completely forgot that The Lobster was nominated.
Yeah.
That was like a thing where that was a prediction I think you got wrong, right? Because like that wasn't...
No, I predicted The Lobster, I believe.
The Lobster?
20th Century Women surprised me. I think I had... Jackie in the spot there.
I think because The Lobster was like floating around the bubble. Also, I'm like kind of embarrassed for the Oscars, but click on if you guys are like following along on the browser page, if you click on The Lobster, or you can see it, the poster that they have is like a signed poster with like the cast. Like it's not like it gets a picture of the poster that the cast has signed. It's so like you can go online and find like a really high res like picture of this, but I guess whoever was putting up the pictures on here just was not looking and kind of put
are
up
the other ones like that.
No, it's only the Lobster. I was looking through it the day that they announced all of them, and I was like, oh, that's shitty.
Oh, did you end up going back and watching the nomination announcement video?
No, I didn't. Tell us about that.
Yeah, so like I woke up like early to watch the announcement video just because I always think that's a fun thing to do.
What was it, like 8 a.m.?
Yeah, mm-hmm. I think they started around 8:18 or 8:20, something like that.
Fuck that, I'm not.
Well, I mean, well, when I explain it, it's going to sound even dumber why they didn't just start at 8 on the dot. But like,
right,
usually they like have a live announcement. They'll have like 2 or 3 relevant actors or actresses from the year before. Like, I think last year was like John Krasinski and
right,
someone else.
Mm-hmm.
Year before that, it was like Anthony Anderson when that like Blackish show had started and
right,
somebody else. Just, you know, fun people who can bring a little bit of like excitement to like something that's happening at 8 in the morning.
Right.
This
whoever's
year,
available.
Yeah. this year, and it's not like it's the
who doesn't have a project.
It's not like it's the most exciting thing because they're really just reading names, but it's still it's a live presenter, so they can kind of come up with like jokes on the spot and stuff, and it's live TV, so it's like
right
a little bit more interesting. This year they did just a pre-taped segment, like with like all these different actors and actresses and filmmakers who had won stuff, won Academy Awards, kind of giving advice to new nominees.
Oh, that's so weird.
And it was arranged so weird because like it wouldn't be like. You could tell they had done like long interviews with them that were like semi-scripted too. Like, oh, say something more about that. But, right. And then they would just kind of pull snippets out of that and try to sort of arrange it to fit the next category that was going to come up. Mm. But it never like fully fit. Like it wasn't like a, when a presenter would be like, oh, you know, this is the thing about like writing and whatnot or blah, blah, blah. Like it would just be really weird. And like the people they picked were kind of weird. Like Terrence Howard was one of them who like... I don't know. Right. Has he really earned the right to be like?
I don't know.
He's just, he's a kind of a controversial figure that, with his like abuse of his wife and then like the like alternative math that he's trying to like support.
I forgot about the alternative math.
It was something where he was like.
There's like a really great interview like where they wanted. Somebody wanted to interview him about Empire, but like they, he took them to like his like. Flat or like apartment or whatever in the city, and he's got like geometric shapes everywhere, and he's like, we've been learning math all wrong, and the interviewer is like, okay, this is the interview now. But I think that's sad that they did that, because like I think even we like that kind of tradition so much of kind of early in the morning, presenters that so much that we parodied it in our handy video where we're like, oh, it's so early in the morning.
Came out the day before the Oscars, and then they didn't even do that.
Right.
I mean, I guess we technically pre-taped, but we were trying to imitate
it. Right.
And it also just annoyed me because it's like, why am I waking up at 8 in the morning if you guys aren't even waking up at 8 in the morning, besides like one guy who's hitting like, you know, put to public or whatever on the website.
Right.
Like, taking it off private. So I just thought that was real dumb. But back to writing original screenplay. I think 20th Century Women is the only one we didn't review for this category.
Seen it,
Heard good things. I mean,
same.
I think
it's the it's like a the Michael or Mike Mills or whatever says it's like an indirect sequel to like Beginners or something. Like it's the in the guy. Same vein as and I loved Beginners. That was a great movie. Christopher Plum won the Oscar. Is that what it's
indirect sequel? Wasn't Beginners present time and 20th Century Women is like the 70s? Like
whole
sexual revolution.
So I think it's concentrating more on like a single mother kind of instead of Beginners was different. It was more like mom died and now dad is coming out of the closet kind of. And
I can see, I haven't seen the movie, but I can see 20th Century Women just because it was well reviewed, and a lot of times almost as dumb as it is, like the Academy will kind of nominate people almost as like a throwing them a bone for like not getting nominated in like another category.
Yeah.
La La Land is the one that really bugs me here. Like,
yeah,
we didn't like, we weren't, didn't have like glowing reviews at a Lobster, but it is an incredibly unique original story.
Right. But I also think, and again, I don't know what I would put in the place of the I like that the Lobster's here and being represented, but again, I think a lot of the movie's problems were from the screenplay. Like the pacing was so bad, and maybe that could have been with editing, but I think like they wrote like two completely different two different movies. Like I don't know, it was just,
I think the acting was also one of my problems with the Lobster in terms of like just how they all had that same deadpan delivery, but then some characters were supposed to have it, and it was like they didn't have enough of a contrast between types of delivery, so it didn't make certain characters stick out. But yeah, La La Land is the one I have a problem with. Like, I don't see what was so inventive about that storyline. It was very tired, and
it's also weird nominating a musical for best original screenplay.
Yeah, I have to admit, I've never actually read a script for a musical. Like a film musical, like I've seen it on like when I was in plays in like high school and stuff, but like I don't know, what does the film script look like? I guess you would have to write it while working with the musical writers as well. And then is it just a song break and they don't know what the song is going to be? Or
and it is. It's not an original film. It's not like a really like original idea is what I meant to say.
Yeah.
And I feel like this is the product of somebody or a lot of people who loved La La Land and just put it down the list.
Yeah.
Like anything they could nominate it for. You know, I feel like people want that fucking like... They want that, like, oh, La La Land should be, like, the next fucking Titanic or whatever has been up for, like, so many... yeah, I think it's a little out of place here. I don't know.
I mean, Manchester by the Sea, absolutely deserving. Mm-hmm. Hell or High Water, very
definitely
much deserving.
Yeah.
Let's move up on the line. You want to read those?
Yes. So we're going to talk about best writing for adapted screenplay. And the nominees are Arrival... Fences, Hidden Figures, Lion, and Moonlight. Yeah, I don't know.
Hidden Figures is the one that stands out to me, and maybe Fences too.
Mm-hmm. What was Hidden Figures based on? A book, I guess?
The book, yeah.
I know Lion was like a memoir.
It was an actual book, yeah. Memoir book.
And then Arrival Moonlight was a short story.
Like, Arrival, absolutely deserving in here. Uh-huh. Wouldn't mind if Arrival won as well.
Uh-huh.
I think Moonlight is projected to win.
Right.
And obviously, I would have no complaints if Moonlight won as well. But, like, Arrival is, like, really doing a great job of just getting across that, like, complex linguistic language.
Right.
And little linguistic side notes and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And then Moonlight has that fantastic dialogue.
Right. It was very poetic versus very... They're two different movies. It's hard to compare them. Again,
Lion I liked. I don't know that I need an adapted screenplay nomination mm-hmm. for Lion. I don't hate it. It doesn't really strike me as like one of the best written adapted screenplays of the year.
Mm-hmm.
And then Fences, as was well documented in our review, just seems like he just copy-paste the play script.
They read the play.
Yeah. It was August Wilson doing... his own adaption.
Right. But I mean, still, they read the play.
They read the play on screen. They read the play.
Right. Yeah. And again, it's weird kind of celebrate. It's weird celebrating four screenplays that were maybe like written in the past year or two or three, and then like celebrating Fences, which was written in like the 80s or something.
Yeah. And well, I think he did the screenplay in like 2005 or something.
Still, I mean, there wasn't like a huge difference between, even if he's adapting his own work. I don't know. Yeah.
We got visual effects, Deepwater Horizon, Doctor Strange, The Jungle Book, Kubo and the Two Strings, and Rogue One, Star Wars Story. Again, 4 out of 5 reviewed. I think we had all 5. Yeah, all 5 and the other one. Hidden mm-hmm. Figures isn't out yet, but that'll be out in 3 weeks.
Right. We did it like a really... I said this when the morning that the Oscars came out. Again, we had a pretty clear idea of what the Oscars were going to look like this year.
Mm-hmm.
But there weren't really a lot of surprises on our end. Literally, if you look over the nominees, there's very few films that we didn't review this year.
Yeah, and it's a lot of the like smaller 1 or 2 nomination films or like foreign films and documentaries and whatnot.
I didn't want to review Deepwater Horizon.
No, I still don't.
I obviously don't have a problem with The Jungle Book. I think The Jungle Book should win. I don't like it as a film, but I think it was the craziest thing that I watched this year as far as visual effects.
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe Doctor Strange had some like really crazy visuals, and Kubo was like very unique. I think they even invented some form of new animation the way that it was done.
Yeah.
But The Jungle Book was like literally you have like a series of very high powered computers rendering hair for like 3 days, you know?
Yeah.
It's the best thing we've seen so far in 3D animation,
yeah.
I think.
Yeah, I think I would agree. Although I just hated that movie so much that
I would love something else to win. I really don't care about
it. I would really love if Kubo took an award here. I just think that would be kind of cool to have an animated movie take visual effects, you know, maybe bring some more repute to that that studio.
And it's like I said before, it's almost like they're in completely different categories.
Yeah.
Because you have a live action and you have somebody who's animating like paper. Like, you know, like it's...
Yeah. I mean, I guess the thing is that it is actual objects that they're filming with the real camera.
Right, stop motion.
So...
Yeah. What the fuck do they do in deep water? I guess like maybe the fire and the smoke or the explosion.
Yeah, I guess.
I don't really know. I guess I'd have to see the film to see what the great visual effects are.
I think it might also just be a product of like not a lot of like the Marvel movies were like fantastic looking this year.
Even Doctor Strange. I mean, it was, I don't know. I know
there was some cool, yeah. I mean, yeah. There was some inventive stuff too, like with the mm-hmm. whole time stopping or right. going backwards thing. All the fights, the like Inception building bending stuff,
mm-hmm.
and then like the other universe like dimension right. stuff. There's just a whole lot of stuff that they had to create, and it all looked pretty convincing.
Right.
God
damn it. God damn it, Academy. This is the year that Paul Dano rode... rode Harry Potter like a fucking jet ski while he's farting across the ocean. And you guys are putting Deepwater Horizon in here. I mean, I could make the... Obviously, I could make the fucking Swiss Army argument about any everything. I think, yeah, it's very prominent in the Handies, but still. Like, come on, guys. Get your fucking shit together.
Yeah.
Even though that was a lot of practical effects, too.
We got sound mixing. You want to read those?
Yeah, sure. Sound mixing. The nominees are Arrival, Hacksaw Ridge, La La Land, Rogue One, A Star Wars Story, and 13 Hours, The Secret Soldiers of Benghazi.
That was the one that surprised me in this category.
Yeah. Where did that come from?
I really like... I would love if Rogue One would win for sound mixing in this category.
Mm-hmm.
Just because, like, now that I've seen it twice, I went back to see it with my little siblings. And if you're, like, paying attention, like, in that whole, like, last battle sequence, like, there'll be, like, the action that's happening in the forefront, and then they animate, like, out of focus, like, ships crashing in the background or, like, you know, laser blasts going off in the background. And all of that is, like, really well mixed. And so, like, you'll just hear, like, a slight explosion in the background. There's just always stuff, like, in every scene that they filled the background out with that needed to have sound mixing done on it.
Yeah.
So I can see that being a very worthy... honor. Hacksaw Ridge, I guess war movies are always going to be for this.
Yeah, this is something where I almost don't like knowing when we have this sort of like predictions, you know, we're going on to like Gold Derby or whatever and seeing this you know, mass of professional critics kind of predicting what's going to be nominated or whatever, and I think we knew Hacksaw Ridge was going to be up for the sound mixing.
This is, I think it's supposed to win sound mixing.
Right.
Or maybe it's the other one about the sound editing.
But still, I went into Hacksaw Ridge being like, this is going to be good sound, and I came out and I was like, I guess that was good sound. I don't know. Like, and I kind of like, so now it's just like in my mind that I was like, I like the sound in Hacksaw Ridge, and I kind of like, I don't know, like I can't think of... Like, it was war?
Yeah.
It was...
I don't know why La La Land is up, besides, like, yeah. I guess they have to mix the music, but the music didn't seem like it fit too much mixing-wise. Like, the vocals, because they were singing quietly and, like, close to the mic, they would have to, like, boost the levels in the mix to make it, like, audible,
mm-hmm.
but then it would just sound unnatural how loud they were singing.
Yeah. Because they're
like,
again,
it seems more like they're
whisper
the
jazz
was like,
music.
The mixing was like a band-aid rather than like
right.
doing good work. But I mean, with any of these categories, I'm these are voted on by people of like the audio guild or whatever they call
definitely.
It.
In the, so there must be something, or they have friends who are mixing.
We got sound editing, Arrival, Deepwater Horizon, Hacksaw Ridge, La La Land, and Sully.
Man, Deepwater Horizon scoring that second nom. And, I mean, I feel like we talked about this last year. I was even texting Sabri's sister, who wants to do, like, audio stuff, and I was like, what is the difference between... Because we're texting about, like, the Oscar nominations, mm-hmm. and she was like, editing is usually the person who will put the different filters on a sound and fix it so that it fits more to the screen, whereas a mixer usually mixes the entire audio for the film and will work more with the creative elements or surround sound, Dolby Atmos or whatever.
Oh, okay.
I hope you're right, Sierra.
It's like sort of the opposite of what I thought, because I would think the editing person would be like, oh, pan this left so it sounds like it's over here. I guess that kind of makes sense that they would be.
I feel like
too,
literally.
So the guy's not just louder here, quieter here.
Right. I feel like literally every year we revisit this, like, sort of like, what is sound mixing? What is sound editing? But again, Deepwater Horizon, can't really comment on it. I'm sure, again, I guess explosions are important. Just like, I'm sure like 13 hours for sound mixing, I guess there's explosions and gunshots that need to sound realistic. Again, Arrival for both of them, I like that because there's a lot of interesting sounds in Arrival, both like helicopters and otherworldly.
Yeah, so then sound editing would be them having to probably create the actual Foley for the movie. So Arrival's fully deserving for that because they had to create an original language of sounds for these new aliens. I think I can see La La Land for this just because sound editing would probably involve the production of the music and stuff as well. And like when they're just talking, the vocals sound good and, you know, well edited.
Right.
I don't really know how to talk about these categories because I don't know what I would put. It doesn't seem like to me like there's anything that's like snubbed in these categories because I don't know. Even though I edit the podcast, I don't know all that much about audio.
I know. Yeah. It's...
I know about beer and movies.
But our next category is, I think this is just cold at this point. Cold coffee.
Short film live action.
For short
film,
kind
of just read because I don't know if you've seen any of these.
I haven't. I don't even know how to pronounce that first one. Animus.
Interiors. Something.
La Femme et le TGV, Silent Nights, Time Code, and Sing. I watched like 20 something short films and none of these are these. I went to a
short film premiere thing at the theater in my hometown that had like 12 or 13 short films and they were all Academy eligible. None of them nominated. None of them were even in discussion. Like leading up to the Oscars,
there were some great short films this year. There was one. I don't know. I feel like
it seems like this is also these could be foreign language.
Oh yeah,
because I don't think they do foreign short, do they?
They don't.
Yeah. So
and I mean, it sounds like very like I don't know. I don't want to be like, oh, you know, like. I don't know. Sometimes in other countries, great filmmakers don't have access to what we have here in America. Like everything in Hollywood and in LA, there's a lot of money being thrown around. Mm-hmm. And sometimes, even if you're a very gifted director or filmmaker in another country, sometimes all you can afford to push out there is a short film. Or sometimes that's the only way that you can get noticed because there's so many phenomenal foreign films every year that are just completely ignored by the Oscars. I don't know. I think at some point I'd like to, maybe I'll make a post on our website about a lot of the great short films that I watched this year because I really like them.
I've only seen one for the next category, short film animated. Right. I have Blind, Vaisha, Borrowed Time, Pear Cider and Cigarettes, Pearl, and then Piper, which everyone saw before Finding Dory, was it, I think?
Right, yeah.
Yeah, which was cute and adorable. And
I'm a little sad there's no...
I think that would probably win, would be Piper.
Yeah, I mean, I have no idea what
it was. It was absolutely beautiful looking. Like, it was, like, incredible how real, like, the, like, damp sand looked. Like, was, like, when the waves would come by and then, like... Even the bird, despite being like cartoony in like its proportions, is like pretty real looking.
Oh, definitely. I mean, I think it was And it was pretty emotional. I mean, Pixar fucking dominates with their shorts.
They know how to tug on your heartstrings in 10 minutes.
Yeah, no, definitely. And I don't know. I really like that about Pixar. Like, what a treat that you also get to see
a
short film.
Short one, yeah.
Before, I mean, now, like, I saw, like, The Secret Life of Pets or whatever, and they had, like, a Minion short film before. Mm. And I was like, I don't want this. It was like, the Minions start a lawnmower business.
Is that DreamWorks or?
Yeah, I think so, yeah. I was just like, no, guys, this isn't the point. It's not to sell, like, Minion dolls at Walmart. It's like, there's some sort of prestige to it, making a short film. But our next one is production design, and the nominees for that are Arrival, Fantastic Beast, and Where to Find Them, Hail Caesar, La La Land, and Passengers. I'm just now noticing there's no Jackie here.
Yeah, that I think is a crime.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I think the production design is great in La La Land, despite maybe minus that first scene.
Yeah, that was gross looking.
Arrival, absolutely great to come up with those great set pieces of the room and just the ship itself that has to be, you know, designed.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them. Nothing looked bad in it.
Right.
I don't know. Maybe I'm not the best to comment on it just because I'm not huge into Harry Potter movies.
I can't think of, I don't know, anything really.
Hail Caesar, absolutely deserving in this category. Just like those huge sets.
They built sets that pretty much are like they're just not economical anymore. Yeah. You know, like it was from like a different era, like how much money they probably put into that film. In Passengers.
I think there's just people that I kind of want to see Passengers despite the negative reviews, because I feel like there's certain people that just have a complete hard on for this movie. Which leads me to believe there must be something of value in there that maybe is just getting lost in translation. Or
like the Oscars are just kind of pushing it too.
Yeah.
You know?
Because, I mean, even when I was doing like my sheet, there's certain reviewers that just refused to like take Passengers off of, like, there's people that even had it on like the best picture list.
Oh my gosh.
People had like Jennifer Lawrence for best actress, and then a bunch of like visual effects they had Passengers on. Oh, and I think we didn't get to it, but I think it got nominated for score as well. So there's got to be something of value there. So I'm eager to kind of check that out at some point and see what people saw in the movie that was pretty critically panned.
Right.
But I think La La Land's probably going to win production design on its way to winning a ridiculous amount of Oscars. Is it my turn or yours?
I think it's your turn.
Music, original song. We've got Audition, The Fools Who Dream from La La Land, Can't Stop the Feeling from Trolls, City of Stars from La La Land, The Empty Chair from the James Foley Story, and How Far I'll Go from Mona. So I've only seen La La Land from this. Wasn't completely sold on either of those. I was kind of pulling for the song from Zootopia, Try Everything.
Oh, I would have. I know you have different feelings, but I can't.
Let's get into that. Let's get into the debate in a century.
I wish I wasn't as hungover, because like I'm just kind of like reading through these and reacting to them, and I'm not. I mean, I think there's, I mean, the reason that we're doing the handies is we think we know better, kind of, you know? Uh-huh. And I'm just like not sharp right now. And I'm not like, well, I think this should, like, I could say Swiss Army Man about everything, really. Yeah. But Swiss Army Man deserves to be in here, even though.
Because it's not eligible for original score, but shouldn't it be eligible? Because
right.
Some of the song, even if
are
the entire sound.
Original. Right, yeah.
That's a tragedy here.
It is.
Well, maybe tragedy is a strong word, but
and I mean, there was Swiss Army Man, and then there was also, I mean, Mike knows how strongly I feel about this. Fucking Popstar has so many great, really original songs. They're all legitimately funny, and they're all like really well done, like done by like some of like the top like producers in the rap world right now. Like the entire film, it's a better musical than La La Land. Like.
I wonder if they just didn't push them.
Yeah, I don't know.
To be submitted or considered.
I did, again,
because the movie didn't do that
well.
Popstar
is very
at the box
confusing
office.
Release. Again, it wasn't that great. It's not like a great movie. Mm-hmm. I mean, especially I hold them to very high standards because they made Hot Rod, and again, all of their albums are great. I mean, Popstar literally is like an entire new album. But yeah, I can't believe that was in there, and we have fucking Can't Stop the Feeling from Trolls.
And two La La Lands.
Yes, and two La... Whatever. I'll take that. I don't...
See, I don't know. I think... I don't listen to the radio a lot, so maybe I just haven't gotten, like, this song played out for me. I really just hear it in, like, 30-second clips now and then, mainly from, like, the Trolls trailer, the Can't Stop the Feeling song. I don't think it's that bad. It's catchy.
I just...
And that was kind of the debate in our, like, little squad chat group thing. We're having a big debate over, you know, does something deserve to get nominated just because it's like popular, kind of like a pop song in this. And I think this is one of the one categories where it does. And it's not saying that only because it's popular should it be nominated. It's more just saying that like it's popular for a reason, because it's a really catchy song, annoyingly catchy to the point where they overplay it and people get sick of it. Worthy of a best song nomination?
Here's my beef with it. And again, I haven't seen Trolls. I literally watched the end so I could understand some sort of context about where this song fits into this movie. And they play it, it kind of like plays the film out and like the credits will kind of like start. And I just like, I didn't like How Far I'll Go from Moana. Like, you know, like it, that obviously has something to do with like the plot kind of, or like this song from Zootopia or like Popstar. They sort of, all of these songs excel like the plot. It's kind of like La La Land, Audition, City of Stars. They're both scenes. They're both like, how well does this fit? Like, you know, like you could have, I mean, like applied like that school of thought to like any other category. It's kind of like, yeah, I don't know. It's hard to, but it's just like, Can't Stop the Feeling from Trolls.
But the problem is, though, that like the people who are nominated in this category can only control how the song sounds. They can't control where it's placed in the movie. They're just writing a song, an original song for the movie. So it would be wrong to judge them on, oh, was it over the credits or was it in the movie advancing the plot or not? Because then you're only limiting it to essentially musical movies that have a song during the movie. And then you're completely cutting out a whole separate category. I would be fine with that if you're going to split it and give a separate category, because there's songs that deserve to be...
Wait. So you're rating these films, or I mean, at least you think
they're... I think they're judging these songs on just the songs themselves.
Just playing the song?
That's what the nominees are. It's the people who wrote the song. They don't decide where it goes in the movie unless it is a musical movie.
The film has to factor in somehow.
I don't think it does for this category.
So is it just the Grammys in one category and then the rest is the Oscars? Like, it's just bizarre like how it has
a place to honor songs that were written for a movie, because they won't be eligible for a Grammy if they're written strictly for the movie release.
It doesn't feel... Can't Stop the Feel... Like, I don't know. Were the Trolls unable to stop a feeling?
I see what you're saying, but that's not what they're judging it on. So that's why these songs get nominated.
I guess
it would likewise also be wrong to not nominate songs like that, unless you had a separate category for them to fall back on. You know, like credit songs or something like that, or you know, have musical songs be like an original category, a separate category, and then you know, songs that are just underneath in the soundtrack somewhere.
I guess. Category. I mean, it's just that we have all these categories that are kind of all working as a team to kind of like make like this best picture kind of, and we're sort of like dissecting each of them, and then like this one it's just like, well, who had a good song, kind of like, it's just like bizarre to me. I don't know. I just...
Right, but don't you agree that it would be unfair to be like, oh, Justin Timberlake, like your song doesn't deserve an Oscar because the producers decided to put it at the end instead of giving it like a musical number throughout it?
I think,
or any of these people.
Yeah, no, I think that's fine. I don't...
Yeah, I can't agree with that. I'm sorry.
He got his paycheck. He got like... I don't want to fucking pity Justin Timberlake. I'm not going to like...
Well, I mean, just like other artists of like any kind too. Like, or even this song from like Jim, the James Foley story. It's probably like a documentary of some sort. And that's probably just a song that like plays underneath it and doesn't advance the plot at all. Should that be ineligible?
Like, it's called like the empty chair kind of, like, you know, like there's some sort of metaphorical, you know, like it seems like it, I don't know. I mean, I guess maybe Can't Stop the Feeling is providing a certain atmosphere for Trolls kind of. But again, I literally can't picture that. Like, I'd love to talk to somebody who's in the Academy and just be like, do you put these songs on your fucking iPod and close your eyes and be like, I've never seen Trolls, but I like this. Kind of like, you know, like, it's just, it seems so bizarre to me that that's how they would be decided, kind of.
I don't know. It makes sense to me because it's, you, I don't think you should be able to punish the people submitting a song where, based on where it's placed.
It's not even about where it's placed, really. It's just kind of like, what relevance does this have to the film? Oh, no, yeah. It's, how is it helping the film? All of these categories help the film.
I mean, you not to campaign too hard for Trolls, because I haven't seen it. I don't really give a shit about the movie.
Right.
But you can make an argument that Can't Stop the Feeling is creating an emotion to make you feel something when the movie's over. Like, oh, you know, now I'm happy and I can't stop the feeling. And it's a big happy ending. And then the credits roll and the kids walk out of the movie theater happy and dancing. Like, there is something accomplished by that. Probably of the same ilk that something's accomplished by The Empty Chair, which is probably like a depressing acoustic like song in the James Foley story.
Yeah.
And neither of them are advancing the story. They're just creating a feeling of some kind.
It's just a bizarre.
You can also argue that City of Stars doesn't fucking advance the story at all. It just creates a feeling in a musical, and it's more just an excuse to have a song.
I mean, I'm definitely maybe advance the, I don't know. I want something atmospheric. I want something that's, I mean, yes, Justin Timberlake wrote Can't Stop the Feeling specifically for Trolls, but I don't know. Out of everything on all the nominations, this fucking pisses me off. It's hard to look at for me because I'm just like, really? Is that the best we could do? Kind of like, I don't even
done so many credit songs before. That's always a thing with this category, though.
Yeah, but yeah. All right, let's just move on. It's just like it's so fucking dumb.
And Audition will probably City of Stars will probably win from this category. I think one of the Loud Hollywood songs will win.
Oh yeah.
Is this me?
No, I think this is me. Music, original score, Jackie.
Not Swiss Army Man.
Yes. Jackie, La La Land.
Not Swiss Army Man.
Lion.
Not Swiss Army Man.
Moonlight.
Not Swiss Army Man.
And Passengers.
Definitely not Swiss Army Man.
Where's Trolls?
I mean, Joe and I have talked about this where we, for the first time, like actually looked up the specific rules for each and every category here just to try and understand why certain things would get left out. And Swiss Army Man is ineligible for score because it's not 100% original. It uses works from other artists. Likewise, that's why Arrival wasn't eligible because it has that Max Richter piece at the beginning and end of it that What's-His-Face didn't write.
There's a lot of strange rules specifically surrounding this category. I mean, yeah, again, what you just said, and then like in addition, something like last year where The Revenant wasn't eligible because there was three composers instead of two.
Oh yeah, and we talked about that, and one of them died, so they had to finish it with.
Yeah, so another guy replaced him, and the Oscars were like, I don't know, it kind of looks like three guys wrote this and not two. Sorry.
Yeah, that's weird. So, I don't know. We've seen four of these. Haven't seen Passengers yet. La La Land is going to walk away with it easy.
Right.
It would be dumb to bet against it. I don't hate it as much for this because the musical numbers in that...
No, same.
Or instrumental musical numbers, rather, are really fantastic in La La Land. But there's also some like, baller... scores here. Like,
we do, yeah. We have some really great ones.
This Thursday, our review of Jackie will come out where Joe and I rave about the Michael Levi score. Who's actually a girl. I didn't realize that was... Sounds like a guy's name. I've always heard Micah as a guy's name.
Yeah, I think it's literally... I looked up the pronunciation last night. It's Mika Levy or something.
That makes more sense.
Yeah. And she wrote the She composed Under the Skin, which, again, that should have been up for an Oscar, and I don't think it was. I don't know, but I'm glad she's getting credit where credit's due, because the Jackie soundtrack is phenomenal. What it does instrumentally, it evokes
probably,
a lot of emotion.
It's what I would want to win in this, just because of how well it works with what you're seeing on screen to create a whole new product. Mm-hmm. Like, if you take the score out of Jackie,
right,
or put some alternate score in there, it's not the same movie. Right. And, like, you could obviously argue that same sort of argument for every movie, but, right, like, I look at some of these other ones, like, you know, Moonlight could have sort of worked without any score at all if you were going to go that way. Uh-huh. Lion, you could put a different score in there of just some sort of sad ilk, and it would still kind of work. La La Land, you could have written something different, but I don't see Jackie working as well as it did without that very specific, haunting, creepy kind of score.
Oh, definitely. And I don't know much about Passenger's score.
I mean, it's Thomas Newman, who's always great. And I do remember liking the score in the trailer, assuming that it's from the actual movie.
Again, the Oscars also like to be like, oh, Thomas Newman. Like, kind of just, like, push that forward because he's somebody who's at the Oscars a lot for work that he does on films. And, I mean, I'm sure it's great.
And also John Williams didn't. Oh, he did BFG this year, but no one really liked that.
I'm glad the BFG is not in the Oscars. Yeah, let's move over to the other one.
Makeup and hairstyling. A Man Called Ove.
I think it's just Ove.
Ove. Star Trek Beyond and Suicide Squad. No idea. Looks like someone is old in A Man Called Ove.
I watched it.
Oh, you did?
Yeah. I don't really know where they're coming from. I don't know. The central character, the protagonist, is an old man.
Maybe he's a young actor and they made him look old.
Maybe.
Because that's if. Look, and that they're, good. They're showing, like, the most extreme makeup for each of these.
Yeah, yeah.
And the picture is of a guy.
Yes. And he's the main character. Maybe. I don't. They took a. I'm looking at the photos right now. Yeah, they have a picture of the old man. Yeah, maybe that's a. Maybe that's a younger man playing an older man. I literally watched this movie and it just looks like an old man.
That would speak to how impressive it was.
Yes.
Hopefully it wins then. Well, I don't know. I didn't see Star Trek Beyond. I guess Star Trek makeup's always pretty
cool
to create these new alien races in a distinct visual style. Suicide Squad, I don't really understand. Because the picture they show is the croc, who looked so fake and horrible in Suicide Squad.
Yeah, was that makeup or was that... I kind of liked the croc, like how he looked. Is that like 100% makeup or is that touched up by...
I think it's makeup, yeah, but I don't know. Like it
I didn't
felt like it. He didn't look like moist or anything at all, like a crocodile. And he kind of just—he looked like.
He also stood out from the other characters. Like there wasn't a consistency in the—I don't know—how the film felt.
Yeah, he looked very practical.
Right.
While the other ones would look like something was done.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess you do have the Joker's makeup in that. And Harley Quinn, where even if it's not complicated, someone had to come up with, how are we going to do Harley Quinn's makeup to make her modern Harley Quinn?
See, because, did I talk, I might have said something completely different, but I mean, I think what they did with the look of Harley Quinn, I mean, even if we don't want to get into costume, I think that this, like, her not being dressed up as the Jester is pretty iconic. I think, like,
it's a great decision to modernize the movie.
Yeah,
it kind of almost ends up defining her character in a new way, where she's got like the daddy's little girl
t-shirt
that everyone's buying now.
Yeah, it was a really great. I don't know. I would give it to Suicide Squad. I don't know what it's supposed to go to, just because I don't really still understand.
It was supposed to. Well, I mean, I was predict. I didn't. The big what you would call it snub here is Deadpool.
Yes.
Not being nominated.
Because Ryan Reynolds looks like, my face is all weird. Like,
I did think the makeup was good in Deadpool.
I mean, it's in.
Because those are the best scenes when he was like getting like blown the fuck up and like with, you know, the fire all around him. And like they made him look like pretty messed up in that. And then they even had to do like the little like baby hand and stuff.
Right. I mean, I think it's pretty equal to like Star Trek Beyond or something. Like there's no reason those could be interchangeable, but I'm very glad just Deadpool had no nominations, because I mean, there was a while where we were possibly looking at Best Picture, a Best Picture nominee for Deadpool, and it's nice that there's no Deadpool in the Oscars at all. I'd still take it over Trolls, but... but next we have foreign language films. Again, we have A Man Called Ove. We have Land of Mine, The Salesman, Tony Erdmann, and Tana. And
I haven't seen any of these yet. I've been meaning to watch Tony Erdmann because that's predicted to win.
And you can watch A Man Called Ove on... anybody who has T-Mobile, get on the fucking T-Mobile Tuesday app. That thing is awesome. I feel like every other week now they'll do a... you know, you get
$5
like
coupon
on Fandango now, which is like their Netflix, and A Man Called Ove is on there, and that's how I watched it. And I feel like they add more and more Oscar films, this year's Oscar films, which is cool because you can't really find any of them on Netflix or Amazon or whatever else we use.
The Salesman, there's like this interesting kind of sad story going around now where because of Trump's Muslim ban thing. Not actually a Muslim ban. It's kind of like a weird hashtag people keep applying to that. He's just blocking certain countries and not other Muslim countries. But Iran was one of the countries that was blocked. And The Salesman is from Iran. And now this guy who's nominated for directing it can't go to the Oscars to accept an award if he wins.
That's fucking terrible.
It is. So hopefully there's some way around that. And obviously, I don't mean to make it sound like, you know, the Oscars or film are more important, but it just, it's kind of like a something to point to and be like, these are the people that are being affected by weird laws like this.
Yeah.
We've got film editing, Arrival, Hacksaw Ridge, Hell or High Water, La La Land, and Moonlight.
Nothing was, I don't know. There wasn't like anything crazy about the way Hacksaw Ridge was edited to me.
I didn't like a lot about the way Hacksaw Ridge looked, so
I mean, just even still a bizarre choice. The more it settles, the more I hear people make fun of it. It's, I think Scout was talking about it on Twitter, but just like the fucking, like, it's about like somebody who is against violence, and the entire like first few minutes are just like slow motion, just bodies blowing up and like fighting, and like it looks fucking cool and everybody's on fire, but it's still like thematically it was just like a strange choice, I think. But again, that has nothing to do with editing. But
I would probably, Arrival would be my favorite in this category, just for the editing as you get towards the, I don't want to spoil it for people who haven't seen it, but the ending of the movie does a lot with non-linear editing, not necessarily non-linear storytelling, but there's a lot of weird flashback-esque type things going on. And
yeah, it was cut nicely.
Memories and visions that are being overlaid. And just the editing of it is nice and smooth when it needs to be, jarring when it needs to be as well. Moonlight would be another favorite for me too, just because they have a lot of nice overlay of dialogue or...
Right, Act 1 and Act 2 are cut really nicely because they're not... I mean, where Act 3 kind of boils down to more of something that looks like a stage play, kind of, but Act 1 and Act 2 are kind of like memories of youth, and I think they do that really well in Moonlight. There's nothing really that special about Heller. I love Heller High Water, but I don't remember being like, now that was an edited movie.
It was, I mean, it was solid. I can't point to anything that I thought was bad.
Yeah,
it completely kept you in. There's nothing really about Hell or High Water that ever like broke the immersion for me, which I think is maybe one of the reasons why it's up for Best Picture, is that it's just very solid and you're just in it and experiencing the movie for the entirety.
I said that about Jackie last night, and there was really only
Jackie,
like...
Jackie should fucking be up for film editing.
I couldn't even think about that, yeah.
It's too painful.
What's next? next is documentary short subject. The nominees are, what is that, Extremists?
Yeah, this is on Amazon or something.
Okay.
I'm going to watch that soon.
4.1 Miles. Joe's Violin. What's happening with it?
looks cool.
Joe seems to be enjoying his violin. I'm sure he plays it.
No, he just puts it up and I can't.
And it's got a few strings. It's just
a review
like a
on YouTube.
Hey guys, I'm Joe. I got a new violin. It's got a pretty nice stain here.
Yeah, it's out. What kind of wood is this? I don't know. I'll Oh, it's pretty solid. It's a good violin. I wish I played. Watani, My Homeland, and The White Helmets. I've heard a lot about The White Helmets.
Oh, yeah.
I've never heard of Joe's violin. I've never heard of 4.1 or Watani.
Yeah, I haven't actually looked at the description or trailer for any of these. I just saw Extremis on... Now we're going to go find Joe's violin.
Yeah, I got to go watch Joe's violin.
Oh, this is an interesting category. Documentary feature. We've got Fire at Sea, I Am Not Your Negro, Life Animated, OJ, Made in America, and 13th.
The most interesting nomination here, obviously, yeah. I think we want to talk about is OJ, Made in America. Because watching all the predictions and everything, this was always at the top. And it's probably going to win or...
Predicted to win.
Right.
Yeah.
But this is, I mean, I even had to tell Mike, I was like, I think that's a TV series. Like, it's literally how many hours long?
We ended up looking up the whatever for it.
Right, yeah.
And as long as it premieres somewhere in LA County in a theater with whatever specifications within 2016 first, then it's eligible.
And so, it's 7 hours and 47 minutes long.
Yeah. It is on ESPN, so I've been meaning to check it out on their website and see if I can watch it there. But that's such a commitment. Like, I know I would have to watch it over the course of, like, 4 days. Or I guess figure out how they split it up on TV.
I wonder if anything has ever been 7 minutes and 47 minutes long at the Oscars.
7 hours and...
7 hours.
Seven minutes and 47 seconds.
It really redefines feature length.
Yeah,
because it's like fucking.
And I've only heard great things about it. I'm just kind of like pissed that it's the same year as 13th, which is from Ava DuVernay, the director of Selma. And 13th, I don't know if you've checked that out yet. It was fantastic. It's
a different kind of documentary because, but
it's just it's got like a really consistent visual style. They do a lot of like I think they do a good job of laying out their facts, and then towards the end of the documentary, they take some liberties to create some moving sequences where they've got Donald Trump speaking at like a rally, and overlaid are like footage of like from the 60s during the civil rights movement of like, you know, white people kind of assaulting black people in Selma and Birmingham and all these racially charged towns. And it's really effective imagery on top. I don't know. 13th was really moving and eye-opening for me.
Oh, definitely.
Someone who considers myself like pretty woke. I remember watching it and being like, I had no fucking idea that some of this shit was going on.
I've heard really great things. I mean, I've even heard people say I Am Not Your Negro is even better than 13th.
I think it's going to be one of those three, if not OJ Made in America, one of those two.
It's a fucking year of OJ. I mean, like, this came out. And I mean,
American Crime is
cut into.
I think there's another OJ documentary this year too.
there is, and I mean, OJ Made in America is cut into episodes on ESPN.
Yeah.
You know, on TV, it played as a TV series, kind of. So it is kind of a TV series, and I mean, there is another TV series about OJ, which is that you were just talking about.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So anytime I'll talk about OJ Made in America, it's kind of a very confusing conversation. People are like, oh yeah, the one on FX. And I'm like, no, it's this like ESPN documentary. And it's not even a 30, what is the
documentary? It is 30 for 30.
30 for 30, but it's like its own offshoot of like, it's a series by itself kind of, you know?
Yeah, but it is 30 for 30 production.
Oh, definitely. Right. So. Yeah. They did it. And they do great work. Again, I'm not like a sports person, but I've watched a few of those.
They're always tear-jerking documentaries. Yeah,
I don't know anything about Life Animated or Fire at Sea.
Yeah, not sure about those. But if you're going to bet on OJ Made in America despite the length.
I don't even know if I can sit down and watch that. I
want to just because I've heard nothing but like,
yeah.
I think it's got to be great if that 7 hours people are willing to be
it
like,
it has
yeah.
to be.
I mean, I've heard that it basically, because it doesn't just look at the trial, it looks at, like, why did we care about OJ before the trial? Mm-hmm. What did OJ's trial point out about us as a society? And then what was the aftermath, kind of?
Oh, definitely.
I could definitely get into that.
But yeah.
Is this me?
Yeah, that's you.
Directing, we've got Arrival, Denis Villeneuve, Hacksaw Ridge, Racist Mel Gibson, La La Land, Damien Chazelle, Manchester by the Sea, Kenneth Lonergan, and Moonlight, our boy Barry Jenkins.
Why is Mel Gibson nominated?
That one I didn't predict.
That's a surprise. I think that was a surprise for everybody.
I was thinking, like, it was going to be Martin Scorsese, just from, like, 14-something nominations before, you know, that usually tends to play a little bit of a role. And Silence was a pretty well-directed movie, I thought.
Oh, definitely. Somebody knew. It's his passion project. I think he knew
exactly.
Like,
he got nominated for, like, Hugo before. And if you're going to nominate him for Hugo and not for Silence, I think that's kind of...
What is it about, like... I didn't come out of Hacksaw Ridge
I think there's literally, like, a generational divide between people who enjoy Hacksaw Ridge and don't. Because I saw it with my mom, and she thought it was amazing. And I just could not get it.
Yeah, I don't
know. People like those, like, inspiring war stories. And I think people from that generation like heroes. I think that's why Sully did really, really well. Because they like a hero. Mm-hmm. Where I think people from our generation are like, no, I want to see that this person is as fucked up as I am, like, has flaws and is a real person.
We like complicated characters. I mean, that's why I think a lot of old people don't respond well to something like Breaking Bad, or, like, you know, like...
Although, interestingly enough, my mom loved Breaking Bad.
That's good. I mean, yeah. But still, there was nothing in this film where I was like, I don't know, like, was he giving, like... I don't know. I don't know what... directing did to that film. I don't know.
I mean, maybe they just were happy to see him back.
Yeah.
Because he was, it, like, a comeback, you know, there was a glory, you know, era of Mel Gibson in Hollywood directing and acting.
Right.
And maybe they thought that he kind of served his penance by being away for 5 to 10 years after his whole outburst and then kind of coming back. Costume design. Oh, we didn't really talk about who should win in directing. I mean, who will win is Damien Chazelle for La La Land. I would love Barry Jenkins to win for this.
Same. I would love him, or I would love Kenneth Lonergan or whatever, just because he's had a heart. I think, like, studios don't really trust him as a director, and I think we talked about that during the... And that's a weird reason for somebody to want to win. I think Barry Jenkins deserves it more.
I mean, you can make a agreeable case for Kenneth Lonergan. Just usually when a cast, an ensemble cast, is that good, it's because the director is at the helm and making them all work together very well. I think you have the same case in Moonlight, though, too, of an ensemble cast, but I think you could definitely make the case for Manchester by the Sea. And then I think Arrival, you can just make the case for how well he was able to construct just a different kind of, like, sci-fi movie, you know?
Right.
And the other two just don't really deserve to be in this category. Yeah.
Up next, we have costume design, Allied, Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them, Florence Foster Jenkins, Jackie, and La La Land.
Allied, the movie that broke up Brad Pitt and Angelina Jolie.
I love how, like, La La Land is just, like, it just has a picture of Ryan Gosling
in a suit.
In a suit. What? It's like, even the costumes in it were kind of, like, I mean, Exhibit A, we had the first scene where everybody's wearing the most fucking... dumb,
boring
clothing. And then I guess something that they thought kind of made the film pop is, like, when Emma Stone and her three roommates, who are all, like, wearing primary colors, you know, like, or whatever, they're just wearing solid, like, I'm red, I'm yellow.
I
mean, like,
I think maybe, like, they might be looking at the ending sequence with all the different costume changes and how those do kind of fit pretty well with the background to kind of create a really unique sequence.
Yeah.
I don't care a whole lot about these categories, just because they are voted on by people from the costume guild or whatever guild you would call it. Allied, I guess, recreating Nazi costumes is hard, even though we've done it a million fucking times.
Yeah, really.
I mean, I think Jackie deserves to win in this category just for creating, recreating an iconic like look from one of the most iconic fashion figures, and using those looks to create different emotions in different scenes. You know,
right? Yeah.
Like I was reading a review somewhere where they were talking about the scene in Jackie. We didn't really talk about this in the review, so I'm not spoiling anything for next week. But when she's wearing that pink, that really iconic pink suit that's got JFK's blood all over it. And then in the movie, when we see her taking that off and taking like the bloody pantyhose off and just like seeing the first lady in kind of like her, her undergarments, but like it's just really well constructed, the entire idea of that costume to create that feeling of like she's literally shedding like her, her public persona so that she can let out her grief alone. And Florence Foster Jenkins, I don't really have a problem with. They do a good job of kind of creating that opera costuming appropriate to the time period. Nothing really stuck out. Fantastic Beasts, I guess. Old-timey clothes.
Yeah.
And I also really wizarding costumes.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Oh, yeah. Is this yours?
Cinematography. We've got Arrival, La La Land, Lion, Moonlight, and Silence. Oh, I think Arrival is the first time an African American has been nominated for cinematography, if I'm not mistaken.
Really?
I'd have to look it up.
That sounds believable. If I were listening,
Bradford Young,
I'd believe you.
Sounds about right and on par for the Oscars. Yeah, in January 2017, Young became the first African American cinematographer to be nominated for an Academy Award. So, I mean, I guess kudos to the Oscars for finally getting it right for once. And maybe like a tiny belated we told you so kudos to Hollywood for finally giving opportunities to some people of color in the industry.
Really?
Across the board and not just in the visible acting categories.
La La Land deserves to be here, I think, besides the first scene. Silence obviously deserves to be here. Moonlight obviously deserves to be here. Lion obviously deserves to be here. I think my biggest complaint is with Arrival, or at least that's the one. It's not like Arrival had bad cinematography. Yeah. That's the one that I think I would remove, just because I think Jackie needs to be in there. I think Jackie had phenomenal cinematography, some of the best cinematography of the year. And Arrival was just, it was kind of boring. I just, like, I wasn't, like, it had some good shots, but the entire film, I was just kind of like... Okay, like, and again, I said this to Jordan.
They do make some unique choices, like in trying to create tension when they're inside the alien ship. Uh-huh. They also have the cinematography of like making them like floating in the air and like shooting that down or up,
right, right.
When they're not facing that way, and then when they flip the image when they're inside, helps to create some tension. And then I think they do. He kind of ends up mimicking, I can't remember, who is the cinematographer for Christopher Nolan's films?
I know who you're talking about. I don't know.
He really creates that like Christopher Nolan, like it reminded me of like The Dark Knight towards the end. A lot of cinematography, or even like Inception, just like the especially the scene at like the gala.
Right.
Where she's talking to General Shang or whatever his name is.
Yeah, I can see that.
And I don't really mind Arrival, but I do think Jackie is more deserving. And I think if you're going to pick a weak link here, it's probably Arrival.
I was about to ask if you had to pick one to take out, what one you'd
take. It would still probably be Arrival.
It was just...
If we were going to do six, I have no problem with Arrival being in here and Jackie being the other one.
Again, it wasn't bad, but I think I was saying this is like a personal bias, but I literally watched Sicario like a few weeks before I watched Arrival, and it's the same director, and it was just like... Roger Deakins, who did cinematography on Sicario, just fucking like blew it up to the next level. I was like, yeah. Like, I
we
think
also
we were talking about
this
last
Hail Caesar
night.
He did this year.
Right.
He could have been up for.
Oh God, yeah. I would replace another one of these with.
Or even
Hail
Swiss
Caesar.
Swiss Army Man could have gotten something too. I don't know that I would put Swiss Army Man above.
I would apply that. I mean, I would apply that statement to every category. But yeah. I would replace one of these with Hail Caesar because I thought. Hail Caesar had phenomenal cinematography. But I feel like cinematography sometimes is like, I don't know, it includes like a lot of the best picture nominees. Mm-hmm. It's kind of similar to director in the way they nominate things. But next we have animated. Were you going to say something about cinematography?
No, I couldn't remember. I thought this was my category, but it might be yours.
Next we have animated feature films. We have Kubo and the Two Strings, Moana, My Life is a Zucchini, The Red Turtle, and Zootopia. Zootopia is going to win?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Kubo would be the one to maybe upset it. I don't think these other three really stand a chance. I think it's weird that Finding Dory didn't get nominated. I know.
Same.
It wasn't horribly critically reviewed. It had decent reviews, and it made like the most money of like anything this year.
I genuinely liked it too. I'm sure if I went back to watch it, I'd be like, meh. That kind of has been happening. I tried to get Sabri to watch Zootopia, and we both got really bored. I was just kind of like, this isn't as good as I remember. Mm-hmm. But I don't know. I've heard the Red Turtle's really great.
Studio Ghibli?
Yeah.
Post Hayao?
Mm-hmm. And I think it's like a completely like there's no dialogue in it.
Mm.
I don't know. I could just be making that up. I've never heard of My Life as a Zucchini.
That's a foreign language. Because it was...
Gotcha.
That was possibly going to be up for two, and one of them being foreign language film as well.
Gotcha.
I'm glad it's Moana there. Had zero interest in, to be honest.
Same. The only reason I want to watch it is because if it's better than Finding Dory, you know, like... Or, I mean, it was chosen over Finding Dory.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's very... I feel like it's very rare that Pixar is left out of this conversation.
Yeah.
So... Yeah.
Especially to get beat twice by Walt Disney.
Yeah, seriously.
What do we got? Actress in a supporting role. This is a good one. Yeah. Viola Davis for Fences. Naomi Harris for Moonlight. Nicole Kidman for Lion. Octavia Spencer for Hidden Figures. And Michelle Williams for Manchester by the Sea. We've done all of these. Hidden Figures hasn't come out yet. That'll be out in 3 weeks. But I think we can effectively comment on all five of these.
Right. Again,
I mean, Viola Davis is going to win.
Right.
I would much rather see Naomi Harris, I think, for this.
Oh my God, yeah.
But it's hard to say. Like, Viola Davis is a great performance. I just almost don't truly believe it's a supporting role.
Well, that's the thing. A lot. I mean, maybe the Oscars didn't say anything, or the rules are a little bit different. But I said this during the Fences review. Is that a lot of awards were like, no, what you're doing is faulty. Like they kind of like almost penalized her for like, you're not a supporting role. Like they, by our rules,
yeah.
What you did, like just because, you know, I mean, obviously her people definitely push for this because I think Emma Stone is definitely going to win best actress. So they want her to win something too, kind of. I don't know. I think even Denzel Washington was like, her role's not supporting. Like, she was definitely...
She's in the entire movie.
Uh-huh. Right, yeah. So, she's in here to win. And then I guess that's just how the Oscars work. And it's not like I can be mad at... It's a great performance. And, like, I definitely want her to win an Oscar. I mean, not above Naomi Harris. Her,
or even Michelle Williams, who is like the second runner-up. Or yeah. First runner-up.
Yeah. Yeah, and again, that role is so small, too. But it's, again, it's very... We have, like, the one conversation at the end, which is fucking heartbreaking.
Mm-hmm.
And then we kind of see her in a single flashback? Or
you do have one or two phone conversations and then her showing up at the funeral.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
But, I mean, she's effective in every single minute that she's in that movie.
Right. My heart was broken.
I know yours was too.
But Naomi Harris deserves to win this.
Yeah.
I don't have a problem with Octavia Spencer. I said that last night. I can't think of... Who do we have in the handies for this?
For supporting?
I think we even got like Scarlett Johansson, which I'm like not crazy about, but I feel like we ran out of people. Okay, Imogen Poots, which again, she's good in Green Room, but she's not like, I don't know. I think Naomi Harris is just a standout performance. She deserves this award, she deserves the handy, and she deserves an Oscar, but I think she's only going to win one or mm-hmm. none of those.
Yeah. Is this me again?
No, this is me, I think. Right, did you do the last one?
I can't remember. It doesn't really matter.
But actor in a supporting role is the next category. We have Mahershala Ali in Moonlight, Jeff Bridges in Hell or High Water, Lucas Hedges in Manchester by the Sea, Dev Patel in Lion, and Michael Shannon in Nocturnal Animals. And I think this is another one where this wasn't as widely disputed, but I said this time and time again. I think Dev Patel he deserves to be up for Best Actor instead of Best Supporting Role. And again, maybe he had more competition, but like it is his story, I think.
It is, but it ends up falling under, like, I think this does fall under being eligible under the guidelines, which are, like, you know, generally the actor is the one who has the most screen time and the supporting actor is one with less screen time. And I think his...
So is there not a leading role in Lion, I guess?
I think you can make the argument there isn't. I think mm-hmm. in Moonlight there absolutely isn't, so it's not unheard of.
Yeah, that's very true.
You know, because, I mean, there are people who are in a majority of Moonlight, but, mm-hmm. like, you wouldn't call Naomi Harris, who's probably in the most of Moonlight, without being... yeah, there's no way she would be the lead actress in that.
Right. It's all... Yeah. But Michael Shannon in Nocturnal Animals is like, what?
He's good, I guess. I mean, I think I'd rather him than Aaron Taylor-Johnson.
I would rather
Aaron Taylor-Johnson. But the more I thought about it, because Hugh Grant started surging towards the end there.
Mm-hmm.
And I kind of, I don't know, the more I thought on that movie, I think that actually is a really good choice for Best Supporting Actor. Because it's an understated...
Hugh Grant.
Did you see Florence Foster Jenkins yet? It's an understated role. There's a little bit of complexity he has to portray in terms of, like, this weird relationship. His guy is basically, he's married to the Florence Foster Jenkins character.
Right.
But it's more mm-hmm. like it's, they don't have sexual relations at all. Mm-hmm. It's basically like she's his sugar mama type thing.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
But it's like understood that it's not sexual or anything at all.
Yeah.
So like he's got his own girlfriend on the side, but he's like trying to hide that from Florence. But he also still feels very strongly about her,
uh-huh.
but it's almost more in like a motherly like type way. It's very strange. There's a little bit of complexity there, okay. and it's all played very well. And I do tend to appreciate some more roles like that, I think, the older I get, where I don't need like eating bison liver and
right, yeah.
adopting a completely new accent to consider it acting.
Yeah.
He has some pretty heartbreaking scenes in that movie that are well delivered.
Who's supposed to win this?
Well, I mean, I hope Mahershala Ali.
Same.
But, I mean, the Golden Globes really surprised me with him not winning for that. The only thing I can guess, but, I mean, I don't know, because I was thinking, like, maybe just Moonlight didn't resonate with foreign writers as well.
Right.
But then it won Best Drama there.
Yeah.
So I don't know. I don't know what it was about Aaron Taylor-Johnson's performance that it had the Hollywood foreign press going wild.
Yeah, I mean, I think he deserves... I would prefer him over Michael Shannon, just because Michael Shannon's just kind of playing a guy. Not so much a... I don't know. That movie's confusing. I still don't know how I completely feel about that movie. But yeah, I would love for Mahershala Ali. I think he's a... I think it's a clear choice for me, at least.
And if Jeff Bridges won, I wouldn't hate it. Mm-hmm. But I've seen him win before, and I would really like Mahershala Ali to get that kind of recognition for his career. He'd be a cool guy to be like the next big thing in Hollywood. Actress in a leading role,
mm-hmm.
Isabelle Huppert for Elle, I think that's how you say it. Ruth Negga for Loving, Natalie Portman for Jackie, Emma Stone for La La Land, and Meryl Streep for Florence Foster Jenkins.
Meryl Streep wasn't originally predicted to be in this.
She surged at the end. I did actually. I think I got all five in this category correct.
Because I think we had, what's her name? Like,
no, Ruth Negga was the one. She was there for a while, and then I can't remember who I had.
Somebody from,
I had someone
like,
in her 20th place.
Century women.
Annette Bening was up for a while.
Yeah.
Greta Gerwig was up for a little while for supporting too, and then fell off.
For
20th Century
lead role,
actress, best supporting
actress. This is lead role.
Right. I'm just saying that people from 20th true. Century both fell off kind of at the same time.
Okay. I watched Elle. It's like a good... It's like a great movie. Like, I just didn't see anything stand out about the performance, per se. Mm-hmm. I was just kind of like...
Is it in English or is it French?
No, it's subtitles.
Okay.
I believe it's French. Very strange movie.
I'm curious to check that one out.
Yeah, it's definitely worth watching. I mean, I'm glad that we got... I'm glad that we have somebody from a foreign film in this category. Again, even though her performance was... I can't believe Emma Stone's going to fucking win this.
It could be Natalie Portman, because it's not like Emma Stone is like clear in a way.
Really?
She is the front runner, but... Okay. Like, if you were going to sign percentages, it's not like 99% Emma Stone. Like... If someone else is going to win, it's going to be Natalie Portman, which makes me happy, and I hope I am.
It would be a pleasant surprise, because she gives the performance of a lifetime. We'll talk about that this Thursday.
And as much as I hate seeing Meryl Streep year in and year out, she's really good in Florence Foster Jenkins. It's just kind of a boring role, because you're like, okay, like she's playing a bad opera singer.
Yeah.
She's so goddamn good at it. Like, I just kind of want her to, like, give up on acting so give other people a chance to win some awards.
I mean, I'm sure
she's too good every year.
I mean, I don't know whether she picked Florence Foster Jenkins. I mean, I'm sure there's a percentage of her that's like, this is a great film and this is a role that I'd love to get behind. But I'm just wondering if her or her people were like, oh, Florence Foster Jenkins, like this reads like an Academy, you know, film.
I don't know. If you watch it, it doesn't come across like it's kind of just a fun, it's more of a comedy than like a drama. It's got some serious moments. I didn't really get Academy like
vibes from it
in my head while I was watching it. I think they were maybe looking at, because the I think the tail end of the leading actress category is kind of thin, and they might have just seen an opening there and been like, all right, let's do a last minute push. There's enough name recognition for Meryl Streep where she's always got a chance for every movie she's in, pretty much. And I think Ruth Negga is completely deserving for this as well. We nominated her for a handy. Emma Stone's really just the one that irks me to my soul and will make me lose sleep at night if she wins.
Yeah. Whatever. And we're going to push on over to actor in a leading role. And we have Casey Affleck for Manchester by the Sea. We have Andrew Garfield for Hacksaw Ridge. Ryan Gosling in La La Land. Viggo Mortensen in Captain Fantastic, and Denzel Washington in Fences.
So this is Casey Affleck's award to a lose. If it's not him, it would probably be Denzel for Fences.
Yeah, but I'm pretty sure. It feels kind of sure thing for Casey.
Yeah.
And I voted for him. I mean, he's at the top of my list for like this year for actor. I voted for him in the Handies, but... begrudgingly, I feel like the night before I read like a very in-depth article about his sexual harassment case. And there's a lot of things that I read that I was like, oh no, I never read that before, and made me feel like weird and uncomfortable. And I'm still kind of wondering why that isn't like a huge conversation, but I don't know.
Great PR people.
Yeah, no, definitely.
Let's just push that to the bottom of the Google search results for Casey.
Yeah. Or even, I mean, it was just
he's probably doing like 20 interviews a day just to keep his name in positive headlines.
Right. And I mean, I think there is something about PR. I mean, again, we said this before on the podcast and it's kind of like an uncomfortable topic and it's like comparing apples and oranges. But Casey Affleck and what's his name?
Nate Parker.
I feel like Nate Parker would challenge things head on, kind of. Like, they'd ask him about it, and he'd be like, well, no. And, like, he'd get upset about it. And I think that's maybe what... I don't want to go into, like, the specifics of what each of them did, but there's definitely a way where each of them handled it, where literally, I feel like Casey Affleck's people are like, and you don't ask him about this kind of, like, thing. Even on, like, Marc Maron was just like, he can't talk about it because... in the court case, they were like, you can't, like, there will be no further discussion about this. And whether that's true or not, kind of, it's a genius thing to say, be like, well, legally, I can't talk about that. Yeah, you know, like,
is
that's
Mark Maron going to be like, show me the contract?
right, yeah. So maybe, I don't know. But it definitely shone a weird light on two of my favorite actors, Casey Affleck and Joaquin Phoenix.
Oh, yeah.
The two of them doing very strange stuff. Very strange sexual stuff.
I want you to send me the link, but I don't at the same time because I don't want to ruin those people. But I guess I should read it if it's out there.
It was so bizarre and uncomfortable to read. Like the producer or director, I forget, or producer cinematographer would like wake up and like Casey Affleck would just be like breathing on their neck and giving them like a massage and he'd like smell of liquor. And she'd be like, what? Get the fuck out of here. And he'd be like, what? What? Fuck you. Fine. And he'd like slam the door and then it would like happen again. Or so. It was just like, and that was like after like hours of convincing them like, oh, we don't need to stay in a hotel. Like my house is like right around here. And it's kind of like making her sleep in a bedroom that he had like the key to, like, you know, like it was just like very,
yeah,
I don't know.
That's probably going to win though.
Yeah. It's a fucking great performance. And last but not least, Best Picture. And we got nine.
We got nine, which I did. I want to just go on record saying I got all nine of these right, even down to the fact that there would only be nine. So pretty damn proud of myself for predicting. We got Arrival, Fences, Hacksaw Ridge, Hell or High Water, Hidden Figures, La La Land, Lion, Manchester by the Sea, and Moonlight. This is not a horrible crop. Yeah. I mean,
I feel like
I think La La Land deserves to be nominated, or at least be in the conversation.
Yeah.
It more just bothers me that it's going to win.
It feels like some sort of like fringe kind of more like something that you said always resonated with me during like La La Land review. And again, it's kind of like what I was talking about with like the audio with Hacksaw Ridge. It's just like, this is all we know is that La La Land is supposed to be the best movie this year and whatever. And you were talking about, what if you like walked into a theater and you're like, this looks interesting, or I have to review this for the podcast, and it's like an indie film and it's called La La Land. Mm-hmm. And you watch it and you're like, that was pretty good. Like, I wouldn't mind if that kind of like snuck in like the back of the Oscars or something. You know, like maybe not... Again, acting wise, nobody should be nominated for this film, but I wouldn't mind it. Yeah, again, cinematography definitely deserves to be there. Whoever colored this film was genius, and I don't want it to win Best Picture, but I kind of don't mind it being nominated.
Yeah, especially in a crop of nine films,
right?
Even the ones that I don't totally agree with in here, Hacksaw Ridge and Hidden Figures,
right?
I don't hate them specifically. I just hate the fact that Jackie was left out.
Yeah.
I hate the fact that Swiss Army Man was left out. Not that that ever stood a chance, but I still think it deserves to be in the conversation for Best Picture of the Year.
I feel like every time we get the Best Picture nominee list, there's always like something where you're like, are you fucking kidding me? Kind of thing. Like there's always, and I don't really have, I mean, Hacksaw Ridge is kind of like that. But I don't hate this list. It's whatever.
Mm-hmm. And there's enough. There's like Hell or High Water is kind of a nice surprising.
It's a cool movie
find
to have in your
to
list.
Have on there.
Uh-huh.
And then like Arrival, Lion, Manchester by the Sea, and Moonlight. I loved all four of those movies. So I'm happy to see that's probably like four of my top ten. So I'm glad to see that many of it, you know, on there.
It's weird that Hell or High Water, like to me, like again, one of my favorite films of the year. But I feel like if I knew I was going to be up for Best Picture, like, how would I would have approached that? Like, when we went to go see that, did we... Was there, like... Was it in some sort... It was in some sort of Oscar conversation, but I think it was more of a long shot. Like, it wasn't...
It was, yeah. It hadn't been released in a lot of theaters at that point, but it was just getting such overwhelmingly positive reviews. I think it was at, like, a 99 or something crazy like that.
Oh,
we
yeah.
saw it. That's why we ended up going to see it.
Mm-hmm.
It was because the ratings were so great.
Yeah, I don't even think it was in the Oscar conversation. Yeah.
Yeah.
But it's a cool movie to have up for Best Picture. Yeah.
And yeah, like we said, La La Land should probably walk away with that.
Should walk away with most of the things it's up
for. So there was 122 awards nominated. And I got correctly or predicted correctly 93 of them. So that'd be 76% of the nominations.
That's very good.
Which I think is decent when you have categories like best short film animated, you know, documentary short, like stuff that I haven't seen. And I think even a lot of like the experts that I look to for guidance on this haven't seen either and are kind of just like, oh,
right, yeah.
Looks like it could be good, I guess. So it's not bad, I think, for my first year.
No, not at all.
I'm looking to do much better at the actual winning predictions this year, which we'll cover. So I think we're going to kind of do what we did last year, where we'll do an Oscar pregame episode sometime before the Oscars, where we'll give our final predictions for the year, maybe run down real quickly, and then review our kind of year 2016 in film. You know, what did we like that we didn't get a chance to talk about in reviews?
Right. There's a lot of films, or I mean, at least a handful of films that came out this year that I would have loved to review on here, but again, we just don't have the time. I mean, especially we're doing like a movie every week, but still, there's just so many great films out there.
We'll see how much time we have. Maybe we'll do like our individual top 10 lists, if that's any different. I'd like to run down in that episode maybe like some of the statistics for the year, like what was our average score that we gave, how far apart were Joe and I usually with scores. And
because I don't want to talk too much about the Oscars, just because I feel like I was telling Mike earlier, I was like, maybe we have just that episode, that establishing shot will essentially just be it will actually be like the season finale of our essentially our second season of just to wrap up the year in film. I think it would be cool to do.
And then we'll watch the Oscars and we'll do an Oscar post Oscar episode. I forget what we called it. We'll just review the ceremony real quickly and look kind of forward to what we're looking forward to in 2017 and prepare for the next episode, which will come out the Thursday after that. First episode of, well, not first episode of 2017, but first 2017 film that we'll be reviewing. And look forward to an awesome another year of reviewing movies with you guys.
Yeah. It's an interesting year in film.
Yeah.
Just like looking at this Best Picture list, it's kind of like, what a weird year.
It feels a little weird. I think last year was like everything kind of felt like it made sense for the most part.
I'm looking at like an Alien movie, a play, a fucking
musical.
Yeah, musical. Yeah, it's just very weird year.
Let's run through some announcements real quick and get out of here real quick. As always, check us out, howmanyfingerspodcast.com, for all our social media links. Vote in the Handy Awards. Voting is going to stay open until February 12th. And like we said before, you can vote using hashtag GiveAHandy2 with your nominee and the category on any of our social media platforms. We're running the sticker contest. Leave a review on iTunes and then email us at howmanyfingerspodcast@gmail.com. Let us know you left a review and give us your address and we'll ship you out some free stickers free of charge.
Get your free stickers.
And on February 17th, we'll pick someone that had the best review, in our opinion, on iTunes and give you a free koozie as well.
Ship you a koozie.
Great value, completely free. Excuse me. Mailing list on our website. Subscribe to our MailChimp mailing list and we'll keep you updated on new episodes and when we post news, stuff about the handies. It's the best way to stay completely
Except
up to date.
When we post nudes.
We'll give you guys some nudes every week.
Hey guys, what do you think about this one?
We'll get our own sexual harassment charges in solidarity with Casey Affleck, the scumbag. You can subscribe to our YouTube. We would really appreciate it just to get some more subscribers, get our unique URL officially. As always, we've got our merch on howmanyfingerspodcast.bigcartel.com, shirts, koozies, and stickers, and a package deal with all three for $11.99. And Amazon link and iTunes link on our website. If you click on either of those, anything that you purchase within the next 24 hours on Amazon or iTunes, respectively, we'll get a little cut of that from there. Very easy way to support the podcast without going too far out of your way or doing something you weren't already about to do anyway. And I think that's about it for us. We'll just like real briefly to say thanks for listening this year. We had a lot of fun.
Oh, definitely, yeah.
Not missing a fucking week of reviews. I'm very, very proud of that.
Yeah.
And now that we're going into the Oscar season, there's going to be even more reviews per week and the Handy Awards and just more content, more life, as Drake would say. So stay tuned for that.
I hope the next time we talk to you, I don't have a blaring headache.
And that we're not drinking
yes.
coffee with curdled milk. It's
curdled milk and bourbon.
Yeah. Not the best choice. But let's get the hell out of here. Signing out for How Many Fingers the Podcast.
I'm Mike.
I'm Joe. I don't know why I looked at you.
This has been a podcast?
This has been a daytime podcast. We'll see you guys soon.